From the Father, we thank you for this day that you have made. It's a good day, yes? Do you agree with me? It's a good day. This is a day we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's a good day. Ah, without this day, our salvation would not be sure. So we thank the Lord for this day. Ah, it's a day in history that has been made, but it's still in our presence. Because of your death on the cross, Jesus, and your resurrection, oh, we thank you. And we can proclaim that you are Lord. Bless us, Father, as we come together. And as we celebrate today, the name of your Son, Jesus. Oh, as we come and we celebrate that resurrection morning. As we come and we celebrate that death has no hold over us. Sin has no hold over us. But we have the victory. We have the victory in you, Jesus. Hell, death, and the grave hold no sting over us because we have the victory because of what Christ accomplished on the cross. Oh, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Church, just begin to just thank the Lord. Come on and just thank the Lord. Come on and thank the Lord. Yes, we thank you, Lord. Thank the Lord. Come on and just thank the Lord. Come on and thank the Lord. Oh, Lord, we thank you, Lord. Yes, we thank you, Lord. Yes. We thank you, Lord. I'm going to thank the Lord. Let me hear the voices of the people and thank the Lord. Hey, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you for our gathering today. Bless us, Lord. Come and be enthroned on the praises of your people. As we worship, Lord, build your throne. Say amen, amen, amen.
Celebrate. Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate. Jesus, celebrate. We've come to lift him up today. Celebrate. Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate. Jesus, celebrate. Let's celebrate our King of Kings. Celebrate. Jesus, celebrate. We've come to celebrate you, Lord.
Sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, he
crucified. You see Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, but he's not here. He is risen. He is risen. He's risen. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Come, let's celebrate the Lord.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
You know you come to celebrate the King.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
Oh, we're gonna celebrate the Lord of Lords. Come on, celebrate the resurrection. yes. Yes. The resurrection. Oh, he's risen.
Oh,
Satan thought that he had won the victory. Ah, Satan thought he had won the victory. Ah, Satan thought he had won the victory. Ah, but today we stand victorious and declare that we have been redeemed. We have been restored. We have been forgiven, because Satan never had the last words, but he arose triumphantly. He arose victorious. He arose, and today we have life and we have it more abundantly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My Savior, Redeemer, lifting me from the miry clay.
Redeemer, lifting me from the miry clay. For my
Hallelujah. Oh, this morning, Lord, we want to thank you for all you've done, Lord, for all you've done. Oh, this morning, Lord, we want to proclaim that you lived and you died, but you rose again on high, yeah. And you opened the way for the world to live again. That is why we give you the highest praise and say, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. For all that you've done, Lord. Hallelujah. For all that you've done. Let the saints say, you lived. You but you rose again on high, and you opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah. For all that you've done, for all you've done, would you just lift your hands and thank him?
Hallelujah.
For all you live, Lord.
You live and you die.
But you rise.
You rose again on high.
And you open the way.
Life today in its abundance. Because you are so resident in our lives, God, that the resurrection power that rose you from the dead live on the inside of us. And this morning we can come boldly to the throne of grace and thank you for all that you have done. It is beyond our comprehension, but all we have this morning, God, is an attitude, a sacrifice of praise. For all that you've done. Thank you, Lord. We want to thank you. Let's take some moment to thank him this morning for all that he's done. Resurrection power live on the inside. No matter what it looks like, no matter what's going on, resurrection power live on the inside. For all that you've done. Hey, yes. Because he lived, I can face tomorrow. Because he lived.
All fears are gone. Any free people in here this morning?
Because
I know.
Because
worth the living. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Come on. Somebody shout a hallelujah. Somebody shout a praise, Lord. Just give God praise because He lives. Jesus lives. Jesus lives. That's why we can say, Lord, we proclaim You now and Your mighty power and Your awesome. Your awesome
majesty.
Yeah, yeah.
Lord,
come upon
us now.
So release
Your power
and let Your presence
and let Your presence.
Oh Lord, we proclaim. Is good. Oh, because he lives, and because his presence is with us, and his mighty power, that resurrection power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, is that same power that lives within you, lives within me. Oh, how wonderful, how wonderful. Please be seated. Thank you, worship team. Oh, good morning all, good morning those online. We welcome you this Resurrection Sunday morning to the house. God is wonderful and great. I was thinking as the song was being sung by the team that because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And because he thought of us before the earth even came into being, you and me, he thought of us. He knew that we would be in here this day, this Sunday, the 31st of March. He knew that every single one of us would be here. And isn't that marvelous that he has us all in his hand so that he knows every hair on our head? Some of us may not have much, but he still knows it. Everything about us, he knows. Ah, he knows our waking, he knows our sleeping. He's a wonderful God, wonderful. Oh, welcome again. Is there anybody here for the first time with us, worshiping with us this morning? Oh, please stand and we'll have the microphone come to you. Just tell us your name and who invited you. Bless you, Audrey. Put your hands together. You related? It's your friend. Oh, bless you. Bless you. Oh, well done. Wonderful. Welcome. Welcome. Anybody else? Oh. Oh, wonderful. Keisha. Bless you. Welcome. We have a number of people today. That's wonderful. Wonderful. Hi, Barrington. Oh, wonderful. Godmother and neighbor. Wonderful. Welcome. Anybody else? Oh, we have a house full of today. Amen. Oh, okay. Well done. Welcome, Paulette. Okay. Oh, well, come on, put your hands together again for all those. We welcome you this morning, and may the Lord bless you. I always believe that you're not here by chance, but you're here by God's design. And if you're here by God's design, he has something for you. And may you be blessed this morning as you worship with us. And those who are online, if this is your first time of tuning in, go nowhere, stay right there, don't press that button. You're welcome to be in our midst and worship with us today. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. All right, now we're going to ask the worship team to come back again, and we're going to collect our mornings, tithes, and offering. Amen, as the ushers get ready. Father, we just thank you for your people. We thank you for those in the house and those online. We bless you for them, Father, and as they give this morning, I pray, Lord, those that are in need financially, that you are their provider. And you will provide. Lord, I pray that their storehouses will never be empty. I pray that you will show yourself strong in their lives as you are their provision for every day, God. Father, may they have clothes on their back, food in their in their cupboards. Lord Jesus, I pray. And Father, bless their hands as they give and the offering that they give and the tithes that they give in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Ushers.
The love of God is greater far than a tongue of hand can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell.
Thank you, thank you. Right now, we're going to have our children's church come to us. They have a presentation for us. If they could come. Jen, whilst you're going, I wonder if you could just sing, Could We With Ink? That's my favorite verse in that song. I remember when I was tiny in church and they used to sing that as my favorite one for some reason, because it was so descriptive. And those who know me know I like poetry, so yes, children's church.
Ocean bed, yeah. And wordless skies, a parchment bay, with every star on earth as well, and every man a scribe by trade to write the love.
Say of God above, what radio
for the children's church. And right after the children's church, Kenroy, please get ready.
Some of what we've been doing since January, and some's going to do what we've been doing for Easter. So we're going to start with Nairi.
It's always difficult on the day, you know that, don't you? Put your hands together for her.
Hi, Skylar.
Hi,
Skylar. So, Skylar, what happened on Friday?
Died on the cross.
Jesus died on the cross. Wow. And Then what happened? Jesus' body was gone. And then what happened? Jesus came back. That's amazing. And what memory verse have you been learning? John 10:10. Well done.
The resurrection. Early Sunday morning, while it was dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran in and found Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved. She said, "They have taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and I don't know where they've put him." Peter and the other disciples ran to the tomb to see the other disciples outran Peter and saw the linen clothes lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed the linen wrapping lying, while the clothes that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying to the side. Then the other disciples also went, and he saw and believed, for until then they had realized that the scripture said that he would rise from the dead. Then they went home.
So, also the little lions, which is the children that are 3 to 8, have been learning the Lord's Prayer, which they're going to say for you now. Okay, now we're moving on to Children of Loyalty and Maya.
About the death and the resurrection of Jesus. On Good Friday, Jesus got betrayed by one of his disciples, Judas. In return, Judas got 30 pieces of silver. Jesus was made to have a crown of thorns on his head and carry a cross up a steep hill and be nailed to it. 3 hours of darkness fell over the land, and then Jesus died. After Jesus had died, they laid his body in a tomb. 3 days later, Mary Magdalene, Joanne, and Mary the mother of James came to the tomb to sprinkle spices and spray perfumes on the body. But Jesus was not there. Only 2 angels where his body had laid.
Sunday school, we've been learning about when Jesus entered Nazareth and when he told his disciples to go and get a donkey and for him, and the the owner would say to them, "Why are you taking it?" And they would say, "It's for the teacher." And so they went and got the donkey, and Jesus rode into Nazareth. And when he came in, people laid palms on the floor for him to ride over.
Everyone is invited. Jesus would have invited everyone to his party, even the people that have been bad. Jesus sees good in everyone, even the two thieves that were crucified with him. One of them asked him for help. Jesus said, "Don't worry, soon we'll be in paradise."
And this is our older group.
This is my interpretation of what I've been learning in Sunday school and youth. Luke 24, verse 6 to 7, NIV. "He is not here, he is risen. Remember how he told you while he restored you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Christ died and rose again, proves to me that I no longer have to sacrifice a lamb for my sin, but he was the lamb put in my place. Because he lives, I can come boldly and confess my sin and be forgiven.
Amen.
In Sunday school, we learnt about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The scripture we learnt is Matthew 28, verse 5. "But the angel answered and said, 'Do not be afraid, for I know you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. This is the basis of our faith. We serve a living Savior.'"
Saints, you know, I just have to say, this little one, she's three. And sometimes Teacher Jackie and I, we wonder, when we're teaching them, is it going in? Are they listening? Because they fidget and they keep touching everything. And on Good Friday, I think it was Siobhan, just said to her, "Skylar, what happened on Good Friday?" And she said, "Jesus died on the cross." And I was just blown away, because I've been praying and saying to God, you know, "God, is it going in?" And he truly answered my prayers, you know. So it's just the confirmation. And just on top of that, just to say to you, all of you in here, you know, when you pray, God does answer your prayers. And keep praying for our children. Keep encouraging your children. Keep reading to your children. Keep talking to them about the Lord, because it is going in. Thank you.
Thank you. Kenroy, can you get ready to come on down? What a wonderful thing, a very wonderful thing, to be free and have Christ within, to be made a joint here with Jesus my. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful. Say, yeah, what a wonder, a very wonderful. Oh.
Hallelujah. 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 Indeed, it's a wonderful thing. Thank God again for another day, another Resurrection Day opportunity. And it's funny that while we are here, you know, rejoicing and accepting the work of the cross and are aware of the whole plan of salvation and all of that, yet when we look in the world, we realize there are so many problems than solutions. There are so many questions than answers. And if you listen carefully, you will hear the questions being asked. Does Jesus care? Does God care? And I'm here to do another piece of my dub poetry, and this is entitled, Who Cares? And yes, we just want to let the world know that in spite of their questions, who cares? Yes, the world is asking, who cares? Yes, who cares when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected? Yes, who cares? Does Jesus care? Does Jesus care? So when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, does Jesus care? So they ask the question, where was God when 9/11? Where was God when 7/7? And where was Jesus on October 7th? When the world was even driven, does he care? Was he here or was he up there in heaven? Tell me, who really cares? Yes, does Jesus care? So when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, tell me, does Jesus care? Tell me, who cares? So when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, tell me, who cares? So I ask you, where was Jesus? Does Jesus care when I tried and failed? Does Jesus care when they said goodbye? When my sad heart aches till it even breaks? When in my deep grief I find no relief? Does Jesus care enough to be there? Does Jesus care? So does Jesus care? So when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, tell me, who cares? Yes, does Jesus care? Who cares when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected? Tell me, does Jesus care? But then I remember the cross. The nails in his hands says, yes, he cares. The crown of thorns he wore says, yes, he cares. The stripes on his back says, yes, he cares. His precious blood that was shed says, yes, he cares. He gave up his life because he cares. So Jesus cares then. So Jesus cares. Yes, Jesus cares. So when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, yes, Jesus cares. Yes, Jesus cares. When the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, praise God, Jesus cares. So if you're wondering if Jesus cares, just reach out to the cross right now. There's deliverance in the cross. There's healing in the cross. There's forgiveness in the cross. There's new life in the cross because Jesus cares. Yes, Jesus cares. So when the motherless and fatherless cry, when the innocent man is condemned to die, when the old is neglected and the poor is rejected, yes, Jesus cares. Yes, Jesus, he really do cares.
Thank you, Ken Roy. Does Jesus care? Yeah, yeah, Jesus cares. Don't get, no, behave yourself, Yvonne. We're going to have, Stacy is coming to sing to us in just a moment. We have a father and daughter speaking to us this afternoon. Our Faith Bent and our Apostle Bent is coming up to speak to us with the word. Before Faith comes in first, Stacy, please come.
Hallelujah.
Who told the sun where to shine in the morning? And who told the ocean you can only come this far? And you told the moon where to hide till evening, whose words alone can catch a falling star. Yes, I know my Redeemer live. I know my Redeemer lives. Let all creation testify. Let this life within me cry. I know my Redeemer lives. The very same God that spins things in orbit, He runs to the weary, the worn and the weak, and the same gentle hands that holds me when I'm broken, they conquer death to bring me victory. I know my Redeemer, He lives. I know my Redeemer lives. Let all creation testify. Let this life within me cry. I know my Redeemer, He lives to take away my shame. Yes, He lives forever. Payment for my sin was the precious life He gives, and now He's alive and there's an empty grave. No, my Redeemer lives. This life within me cry. I know my Redeemer, my Redeemer, He lives. I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer. life within me cry. I know my Redeemer lives. I know our Redeemer lives. I know our Redeemer. Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Bless you, Stacy. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You'll know why in a minute. Oh, glory be. Oh, praise God. Just praise the living God. Praise the living God. Before I get shalom, shalom. For those who don't know what that means, first, one shalom is peace. And if I say it twice, it means peace, richness, blessings, fruitfulness, every good thing bestowed to you. All those in the house, all those online, shalom, shalom. Amen. Okay, I greet the ministers, everybody, in Jesus' name. Before I get started, Lord, I know you live. I know you're a God that restores. And as we come this morning, empty out faith and let you overflow. Let this be a rhema word, a redeeming word, a word that walks with your people, dear God, and they take it and it manifests and be fruitful in their lives in the name that is above all names, the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay. I got a very interesting scripture today. It's a bit mix-match, but I'm giving thanks. Now, you know it's my custom to stand for the reading of the word. It's a bit lengthy. And I'm going to go back to come forward, okay? So we're going to stand for the reading of the word, Luke 15, 11, 32. And then I'm going to go back and then I'm going to come forward. Amen?
all those who can stand. If you can't, it's appreciated. God understands and knows. So, then he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, somebody said, when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, say a great way off, he is a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this is my son. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field, and he came and drew near to the house. He heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry, and he would not go in. Say, he would not go in. He won't go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, lo, these many years I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, he has devoured your livelihood with harlots like you. You killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. Say, all that I have is yours. All that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Thank you for the reading of the word. You may be seated. Okay. Kitsugi. Now, you see, this is why you shouldn't put things up that you can't pronounce. Amen? But it's the principle. It's the process. So, kintsugi, from broken to invaluable. Now, kintsugi is an ancient Japanese method of restoration. All right? So, what happens if you're in your house and you've got a lovely vase that you really like? You know, in the ancient custom, what they used to do in Japan, oh, boy. I love when Jennifer looks puzzled. So, that is good. So, what happened with the vase? Say you dropped your vase. Now, these days, you go to IKEA, you get another one. All right? But what they used to do, or what they do, is instead they gather the pieces, the broken pieces, and they stick them together with liquid gold. Somebody's understanding what I'm trying to say. And then they laminate that. So what happens is, what was beautiful initially, through the brokenness, becomes invaluable. How many of you know that you're beautiful? How many of you know that God loves you? Amen. God loves you. And in your brokenness, He takes that, he restores you, and you become invaluable. Amen? Because when God talks about restoration, I want you to understand this thing about biblical restoration. It is not a one-off event. It's a continuous thing that we continue to do on our journey. It's a continuous thing. Yeah? So that's why it's from broken to invaluable. Okay. Right. Hence, I said I know my Redeemer lives. So what I was going to do really doesn't make sense. Because I was going to ask you, do you believe that Jesus rose from the dead? Say, I believe that Jesus rose from the dead. But then I was going to say, do you know that Jesus rose from the dead? No, say that again. It feels different when you say, I know, innit? When you say, I believe, it's like, yeah, I believe. But when you say, I know that Jesus lives. I know my Redeemer lives. I know he lives. Yeah, so that's why I smiled. I thought, Holy Spirit, you're in here today. I tell you, my message has been preached this morning, almost. Okay, so if I'm going to, and this is for those who go out there, and especially young people, when people say, well, oh, you believe? And you say, well, no, I know my Redeemer lives. And you say, how? Have you got any evidence for that? Because these people are bright out there, you know. They're going to ask you about this, and they're going to ask you that. So this is what you're going to tell them. First of all, my first piece of evidence is Torah and Old Testament prophecies. Yeah? 700 years before Christ, Isaiah 53, 6, 10, and many other prophecies prophesied that the Messiah would come and rise again. Amen? But then there's historical evidence. There's historical evidence. Now, there's not historical evidence for the resurrection. Yeah? But there is historical evidence for the empty tomb. How many of you know the tomb is empty? There's historical evidence for the empty tomb. So not only they not venerated that tomb when Jesus was in it. No, there was no little label, nothing. That little shrine that normally goes outside that Jesus laid here, it ain't there. The tomb was empty. But also the Toledot Jews, and I do not encourage you to read it. All right, I don't encourage you to read it. It was historical written documents by the Jews who wanted to deny the resurrection of Christ. So what they did was they actually wrote about his crucifixion. And then after they wrote about his crucifixion, they wrote about him being buried. But then they wrote about the empty tomb. All right, they wrote about the empty tomb. But they said that the disciples stole the body. But we all know the disciples didn't steal the body. So now you're verifying for me that the tomb was empty. The tomb was empty. And it's still empty today because it's the risen Lord. All right? He's the risen Lord. The tomb is empty. And then there's eyewitnesses. Because you know if you go to court, you need an eyewitness. All right? Just one eyewitness is not going to be enough. So there's eyewitnesses. And if you go to Acts 1 and 3 or 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 8, these are the eyewitnesses or some of the eyewitnesses, all right? The eyewitnesses are Mary and Peter. The 12 main apostles saw him. Actually, not only the 12 main apostles saw him, his disciples saw him. You see, we think that there was only 12, but there was loads of disciples, all right? Male and female, by the way, just to let you know. Oh, yeah, we was up there. Yeah, Jesus weren't distinguishing like that. And then he was walked around for 40 days. 40 days. And when he went around for the 40 days, there was on one occasion that is documented that he spoke to 500 men. 500 men. Now, you know in the Bible sometimes they don't count the women and children. So if we're talking 500 men plus women and children, that's a whole load of people. Amen. All right, so there, and then his brother James, who never believed in his ministry, he made sure he went and saw him, and he became the leader of the church in Jerusalem, amen? And then finally, in that scripture, it talks about the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. So now, you trust me, if you go to court with that amount of witnesses,
I think the judge is going to judge in your favor. All right? The tomb is empty. But the last bit of evidence that we have, and it's New Testament biblical, is about the apostles. All the apostles, how brave and courageous they came after they saw Jesus. And you see, people talk about my friend Doubting Thomas, but I like him. I like him. And you know why I like him? Because in this time that we live in now, you want evidence-based practice. What's your evidence for that? Can you prove that? And so when he showed him his nail-pierced hands and he put it in his side, it was the evidence, and Thomas walked away bold. All of the apostles walked away bold, encouraged, empowered by the Holy Spirit. They were empowered, and they went right back in the, you know, right back into Jerusalem. You know when someone tries to have you up, and you think, oh, I'm not going to walk there again. No. And young people know what I mean. But they're G-checking. You're G-checking, bro. But anyway. They went right back to Jerusalem, right back there, stood there and preached Jesus' resurrection. Jesus is risen. They had the hope. Amen? And not only that, when they were empowered by the Holy Spirit, they did some miracles, man. They said the very shadow of Peter healed people. They did miracles after miracles after miracles. They were empowered, and they were willing to die for the cause. Now, if they made it up and they stole the grave, stole the body, I don't think you're going to go as far dying for that. You know what I mean? That's not. But they were willing to die for the cause. Absolutely die for the cause. So when I say, does they believe? Let me tell you, those, they knew their Redeemer lived. They knew. Okay. The little people have already done this, but I thought it'd be amiss of me not to just remind us all, because sometimes we're sitting here and we think assurance of salvation. What is that? Redeemed. So I'm just going to run through some of the things that Jesus did before I go into the message. Amen. So the guilt of our sins was taken away from us and placed on Christ, who discharged them through his death on the cross. No more guilt and shame. Okay? No more guilt and shame. He turned God's wrath into favor so his love could be actualized without sacrificing his justice and holiness. What does that mean? What it's saying here is God in his whole essence is love. But then God in his whole essence is justice. Yeah? It's not part of that or part of this. He is love at its core, justice at its core, holiness at its core. And so in order to appease his wrath, showing us love, there needed to be justice. And Jesus provided that. And we didn't just appease his wrath, he then changed that to favor. Christ's death removed our alienation and thus reconciled us to God. That means we can now go boldly before the throne of grace. All right? Once we have a repentant heart, we boldly go before the throne of grace, and this is what Jesus died to do for us. We don't have the veil, the curtain was torn, and we can go. We don't have no high priest anymore. Yeah? And he redeemed us. He paid the ransom, redeemed us from the curse of the law, the guilt of sin, and the power of sin. So we're no longer under the law. And it was funny because I was at church last night, and the way the bishop framed it for me was really good. Because when you're under the curse of the law, you're forever, ever paying. You know, like your HP, a car. And it's like the payment's never going to end. All right? Well, that's what the curse of the law was like. We were on paying, never, ever paid off. But when Jesus died, it was paid in full. Amen? Paid in full. Come on. Paid in full. Glory be to God. So the guilt of sin is gone from us, and the power of sin, we have the power of the Holy Spirit riding within us so that we can repent and we can live abundant life. All right? Okay. So, but Christ took the power away from Satan and for all who believe, defeating him and the powers of darkness. Amen? That means you've got authority. You have authority. The devil is under your feet. You have authority. Come on, somebody in the house. You have authority. You can decree and declare a thing, and that thing must come to pass. It must come to pass. Sickness, get behind me. It must come to pass. Come on, somebody, decree and declare it, and it shall be. Because you have the power. We now have the promise of eternal life. Now, each and every one of us know, right, that we all fear death. It's universal. But the beautiful thing about when you die in Christ is that you're reassured that you're going to rise again. You're going to glory. You're going to. There ain't no other religion that give you that. Not even Muhammad. No, see, my God, heaven. Trust me. Look it up in the Quran. I could tell you. See? It's chilly. He doesn't even know. He's the leader. And he doesn't even know he's going to heaven. He's still in the wait. But I'm telling you, I'm going. We're going. We're saved. Sanctified. Holy Ghost filled. Water baptized. Jesus on my mind. And I'm running. I'm running for my life. Because I know I must suck and do. Glory be to God. Alalasha na na na. Sekandana. I'm running for my life. Oh, Lord, glory, glory, glory. And so, all in all, the reality of substitution is at the heart of the atonement. All right? Christ accomplished all of these things above, yeah, and gave us all these benefits by dying for us and in dying instead of us. Amen? So, yes. And thank you, Sunday School, because you've done a great job. Hey, girls, we are. Okay, so as I said, restoration is an ongoing thing, and in the world and in society, you're bringing back to reestablish a previous practice, a previous right, a previous situation, or you're returning someone or something to a former condition, place. But you see, with God, restoration is ongoing, and he's not taking you back to a former place, he's taking you on to a future glory. Your beautiful becomes invaluable. He's not restoring you back to beautiful. He's taking you to invaluable. You are invaluable. All right? Remember that. Not going back. So, the restorative lens. We're looking at the prodigal son this morning. And for all of you don't know, which is majority of you, I'm a restorative justice practitioner trying to get my accreditation. Amen? Yes. So, when you look at the story of the prodigal son through the restorative lens, we look at each individual character one by one. And some of you understand, Selena will correct me if I'm wrong on this one, but anyway, I'm only joking, Selena. Okay, so when we look at it through a restorative lens, the focus isn't on who committed the harm. Because we know that when we look at this young man, the prodigal son, he's the one who doesn't know God. He's rebellious, he's frivolous, he's reckless, and he's taken his dad's livelihood, you know. Right? He's taken his dad's livelihood, and he's gambled, and he's drunk, and he's done his drugs, and he's had prostitution. And we can put all these things to it that he's done. But then he finds himself in a difficult situation. In fact, he finds himself destitute, at the bottom. Nowhere to go, nowhere to run, no friends, no money, nothing. And he just about got a job. And you know the worst thing that he found? He was in the pig pen. Now, if you know about being Jewish, now you're really gone low, yeah? You're really low if you find yourself in the pig pen. And what I'm going to say to you this now, on fun and joke aside, if you find yourself in a place where you feel like you can't get up today, let me tell you something, Jesus can restore you. He can restore you. And he will restore you. But I'm going to look at, you see, when Adam and Eve rebelled in the garden, there was a domino effect, right? So, what I'm trying to say to you is, when somebody harms or does something like the prodigal son, there's a domino effect. Other people are harmed. So now, all we've talked about that, nobody ever talks about the father's experience. So let's have a look and see maybe what the father could have experienced. And I'm saying this today, and I'm encouraging you, and I'm encouraging myself. Many of us have friends or relationships, family members, where some of us are going through some of this. Even sometimes we're at work and it's a colleague. But this young man had no regard for his family or his heritage. Now, we all know, if you read back in your Bible and you think about people like Jacob and Isaac, they were in their old age when they blessed their sons. Their sons never took up their bag and gone back their business out into the Gentiles. Think about it, you know, because we're putting it in the Jewish context of what this dad experienced. What was it like for him? Take the money and go wrap up with the Gentiles. Now, you know you shouldn't be there anyway. You're out of order. He breached his trust, father's trust, and was extremely disrespectful. His father did not have him to rely on. Now, those days ain't no old people home, no care home, you know. Your children's supposed to take care of you. And what has he done? He took the money and gone about his business and never looked back. Now imagine if his dad did have to sell the land that was in his family for years and years. And if you know anything about the Bible and you know the land is important, right? It's important. And imagine if he did have to sell the land and the boy take the money to the Gentiles. Can you imagine how he must be feeling on a real, man? Seriously. He's feeling unappreciated, rejected, and undermined. How dare he? And within that, there's emotional abuse, there's financial abuse. Come on, somebody. Come on. And the wider community, because you know how the Jewish community is already, you're violated. Yeah, it's not, you don't just violate your family. You violated the whole community with your behavior, breaching their laws, breaching their customs, and people would attack them. And gossip is a wicked thing. Yeah? So whilst I'm making fun of it, I stopped myself and thought, have I ever felt any of these things? Have I ever felt any of these things? Have we? Have we? Have we been harmed? But my God can restore my broken pieces. My God will restore my broken pieces. You understand? Okay, so how do we get to restoration? Now, I'm still on the father, funny enough, because this part's quite interesting. As I said, repentance is not merely utterly saying the word sorry, but it's a transformation of the heart, a turning away from sin, and a sincere commitment to walk in righteousness. Yeah? Now, that dad, when I looked at it, the dad said nothing. Did you notice that? He said nothing. Now, he was a good Jewish man, so I know he prayed. But there are some times when things are happening in our lives that we just pray and say nothing. Stand on the word of God. Do you understand? Pray and say nothing. Stand on the word of God, and I know he had an expectant hope. Yeah? He weren't just standing, he had an expectant hope. He did. And the beautiful thing is his son came running back, but he didn't just come running back, he came back with a repentant heart. And it's so much easier to be able to accept the apology, isn't it? When the person's coming to repentant heart. All right, they're not wishy-washy just saying sorry for lip service. God requires from us a repentant heart for our continuous restoration. All right? And we would like a repentant heart if you're coming back to say sorry to me. I would like it. We don't always get it, but I would like it. Okay? So the dad was standing in faith. And we know that he had a expectation, because the scripture says he saw him from afar off. He was looking for the answer. He was waiting for the answer. He knew it was coming. And if you know you prayed for something and you've got an expectant heart, look for the answer. Look, be expectant for the answer. Stand in faith and look for your answer. So what did the father do? Now you see, prodigal means lavish and wasteful and reckless. But I know that my God is prodigal, because what Jesus did on the cross was very lavish. It was extravagant and lavish. You see, I played, you know, may notice I don't have a title for this. I thought broken pieces, I thought prodigal God, I thought this, and I said leave it. So, but yeah. Having or giving something on a lavish scale. And let me tell you this now, whether you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, whether you're in a position where you were a Christian but you're not too sure, or whether you're in the house of God, every one of these things is being awarded to you. All right? Every one of these things. So first of all, he killed the fatted calf. Now, when you had a fatted calf back in those days, the fatted calf was the prime animal. You fed it the best. Nobody touched it. And you only killed the fatted calf if it was a wedding or a prominent visitor was coming. That's when. And look how Jesus loves you. He sees you as a prominent visitor. He sees you as his son that's returned. And this father killed the fatted calf for him. He killed the fatted calf. Yeah? So what did he do? He gave him honor. Gave him honor and gave him respect. Don't matter that he was in the pig pen. He's not interested in what you did. He's looking at your repentant heart and saying, I honor you. I respect you for your truth, your humbleness, your genuineness in being able to come back. I honor you. And then he gave him a ring. He put a ring on his hand. Now, if you know anything about those days, like, do you remember Joseph when he went before Pharaoh and Pharaoh said, here's my ring? Yeah, authority, access. It's like the platinum of American Express. My God, slap, slap, slap. Yeah, whatever I say is done. Yeah, so he weren't no servant. He went away saying, gimme, 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 and he came back to serve. But God said, you are sons and daughters. We are joint heirs with Jesus. We are joint heirs. Therefore, you have authority. Yeah? And you've got access to the throne room. Ask for what you want. Decree and declare a thing. You have authority. You understand? Authority. He gave him authority. But he also gave him a coat. And you know, I do like a Joseph, you may notice here. But he got a coat, do you remember? Technicolor dream coat, as I call it, from the young days. But that shows love. He showered him and covered him in love. No matter what circumstance, what situation, no matter what we've done, where we've been, God covers it with love. Yeah? And not only love, favor. You know that song, favor ain't fair? Well, it ain't fair, but my Jesus gave us favor. So when you get a job that someone else applied for and they think, oh, well, how did that happen? Say, favor. Amen. Favor. Favor ain't fair, but it's awarded to those who repent. And as I said, he gave him his title. That means he is a son. Son of the living God. Son of the living God. But then there were some sandals. And now you're thinking, what about the sandals? Well, when in that culture, when you decided, say, to sell a piece of land, they'd throw down the sandal, yeah, as a contract. They didn't write it out. So when he put sandals on his feet, it was a covenant. It's a covenant. It's a contract that he's made with you, that you have decreed and cleared that he's your Lord and Savior, and now you're in a contract with God. Yeah, and it's very difficult to breach that contract. very difficult to breach that contract. We all slip. The Bible says you fall 7 times, but get up. Get up. Get up. And I'm talking to somebody in here. Get up. It's all right. I've fallen. You've fallen. But get up. Get up. Get up. It's all right. The last thing, he restored him to the community. Now, remember, they was chatting about him from before, so he could have really just kept it hush-hush that he'd come back, innit? For a little shame. But instead, no, he pushed him out there. He pushed him out there. And he said, here, this is my son. This is my son. Come and celebrate. Come and embrace him. Bring him back into fellowship. Bring him back home. Come on. Welcome him. Respect him. Love him. Favor him. Adore him. Recognize. Recognize who he is. Recognize. 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 Come on. They better recognize back there chatting me. Recognize. Recognize. I'm born again. I'm born again. If you're online and you knew something I did years ago, that's cool, baby, because I'm born again. Hey, born again. I'm born again. There's no condemnation in Christ. I'm born again. You understand? I'm born again. Ah. But as we're in the house, and as we can be here for a time, we can't not recognize the older brother's experience. Because he was there. He was there. And he was reluctant to forgive him. He was reluctant. Now, the fact that he came back with a repentant heart, you know, means really we should forgive him. Come on. Because you know the thing about it is, if we don't, the root of bitterness that grows inside you, you don't forgive people for their sake. Let me tell you this one more time. You do not forgive people for their sake. You forgive people for your own sake. You understand? For your own sake, because if you don't, there's a root of bitterness that's going to grow up inside of you. Amen? And while they're partying or while they're excelling in God, you sit on another chair, bitter. We got to forgive. Come on, forgive. Bitter. Yeah, no, it's true. True. Come on. And I can't say like I've never been there, never forgive somebody and then come back and thought, ooh. You know what I'm saying? No, come on, guys. But he also felt overlooked, because he said, you didn't even give me a go. He felt as if he was overlooked. And some of us grow in families where we feel like we're overlooked, or we're at work and the other person's getting promoted and we're overlooked. There's so many things in life we get overlooked. But I said, you see that thing, that emotion when you're overlooked? I said, my God can restore the pieces. Yeah? He felt as if he weren't valued. He weren't valued. They couldn't see him. He weren't valued. But I'm telling you, there's value in God. He said, what did he say? I'm a mama. I said, come on, somebody. What did he say? He said, you're invaluable. You are in him. You're in Christ. You are invaluable. Don't matter if man wants to feel like they value you or not. You're not looking for his validation. We're looking for the validation of God. And when God says you're invaluable, you are invaluable. Priceless. 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 So as I said, watch your heart now, because he was jealous. And that's another thing, because jealousy can lead to murder, you know. Fun and joke aside, trust me, you have to be careful. And if you see it, let's get some repentant heart and say, Lord, help me. Help me. Help me, fix me. Help me. You are the balm in Gilead, now rub that balm right here. Rub the balm, rub the balm, rub the balm. And because of some of these things, he wasn't fulfilling his purpose. He was walking around like he was a servant. He didn't realize the power and the authority he had, because he could have took a goat long time. He could have taken the goat. It's not like he weighed a fatty calf, he wanted a goat. Miss it. Do you understand? So let me encourage you all in here today, don't miss your purpose. Don't miss your purpose. Do not miss your purpose. You've got a destiny, you've got a calling on your life. Yeah? And if we get entangled with some of this earlier stuff, guess what? We miss our purpose. Don't miss your purpose. And walk in the power and the authority that God has given you. All right? Okay. Yes, Lord. So, all right. Ooh. So, what are we saying this morning? Continuous restoration. God's going to take those broken pieces and make you more and more valuable. And he said, you know what, just come to me, lay it down, lay it down, lay it down. It's okay, it's okay. I got you. You're blessed, you're blessed, you're valuable. And he wants to give you all favor. He wants to shower you with love. He wants to give you back your dignity and your identity. Yeah, he gives you power and authority. All of this is yours. So whatever your broken situation is, if it's your marriage, if it's your health, if it's your finances, if it's your family, it doesn't matter. We're going to hold to God. We're going to pray. We're going to stand firm with an expectant end, because we know we have the authority. Come on, somebody. Still that expectant end. If it's your career, doesn't matter. With an expectant end, because he's God, okay? The God of the continuous restoration, the God of the broken pieces, the God of the broken pieces, that's who he is. And I don't know where you want me to take this, Granddad, or you want me to keep going? You want me to take this? Okay. And thank you all.
Come on, big up Jesus. Big Jesus up. Big him up. Big him up. Big him up. Big him up. Big up Jesus. The God of the broken pieces. How broken are you? How many pieces have you been shattered into? There are some repair shops that wouldn't even look at you. But you cannot be so broken that God cannot mend you. You cannot be so broken that God cannot restore you. He's calling you today to be restored. Be restored. Come. Be restored. Into an everlasting restoration. He's calling to be restored. I would love to pray for some of you this morning. You can't sit down under a message like this, and whatever you feel in your heart, why don't you respond to it today? Let me see the hand of those who feel that you should be mended. Mended. Come on, raise those hands. Don't be afraid. You're in the house of God, but it's a place where you can be mended. And God wants to mend you. Come on. Put those hands up. I want to see them this Easter Sunday morning. Hallelujah. I want to pray with you. Broken pieces. Come on. Come on. Stand to your feet. You raise your hands. I want to pray for you. Stand to your feet. Don't be afraid. Stand to your feet because it's the day of mending and restoration. And as you're standing, please just walk straight out here for me. I'm waiting on you. Do it now. You said, but Pastor, I don't feel comfortable. It's my first time in this place. But I don't know what to do. I'll tell you what to do. Push the devil off and come right out. Just come. Just come, just come, just come. Broken pieces. Broken pieces, broken pieces, broken. But God can restore. Come a little this side, please. Oh, Rama Mama, would you come down a little closer to me here? Sharama Mama. Oh, isn't it amazing? We have more room this side, a little closer to me. Shika Palanta Baba Rabba Koto Shetete. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. You know, I thought Faith was going into to say a little bit more about the older brother there. But God know what he's doing. And the word of the father to the older brother was, after he complained and he cried and he make noise, the father said to him, son, all that I have belongs to you. I want you to get that into your spirit today, that all that God has belongs to you. Help me sing that, please. I am redeemed, redeemed. Odima, rodima, sakatara, basha, katalama, baba, robo, sokotasa. Yes, if anybody asks you. You are standing today in the presence of the living God. Those of you who are standing here, sing it as if you're singing it to the Lord. I'm asking the leaders if you would go, the leaders, if you could come out here, please, and just touch some of these people. Let me just ask a personal question here. This is so important. Many of you are standing out here. But let me see those of you who would love to receive Jesus and say, Jesus, come into my heart. I want to be born again. Let me just raise your hand. Just say, I want to be born again. Let me see you. We give special attention to you. There's a young lady standing down there, and she wants to be born again. Come on. Don't be afraid. You're the number two. You're at the right place. Is Joy Joseph here? There's a young lady here who, oh, you have somebody, but just, there's a young lady here who's waiting for somebody. All right, I'm going to do that myself. This is so important, so important. Don't miss out on this. Oh, we bless you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Shegebura bakata rabato romoto sundai. Yes, while you're praying for those individuals, give us a chance to pray with the others. Other people are depressed. Pastor.
Yeah. Love now abides.
Hallelujah.
If there was confusion, peace now reigns.
We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord.
I'm walking with Jesus. I'm a child of the King.
Pray with her.
Oh, because I am redeemed.
Hallelujah.
Where there was hate.
Did you have a song you want?
Where there,
did you have a song you want to sing?
Where there was confusion.
Oh, Jesus, we thank you. Those of you standing here, you're not for salvation. Just pray.
I'm walking.
Just pray to the Lord.
Jesus, I'm a child of a King. Oh, because I am redeemed.
Oh, be robo shadama ba padatoto robo satalaba. Yes, I am redeemed.
Bought with a price. Jesus has changed my whole life.
Change it, Father. Change your lives. Change your life.
If anybody asks you,
Uriaba, 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 Uriaba. Oria batasa kataraba hutorobo. Oria baba.
I'll tell of his favor. I'll tell of his love. I'll tell of his goodness to me.
He purchased my
redemption with his own prayer.
We give you thanks, O Lord, we give you thanks.
And from sin I've been set free.
Shidiya bagando bosetia la mama matusu.
Faithful. Jesus has changed my whole life. If anybody asks you,
Sarah.
Bought with a price. Jesus
Pray for that young lady before you go. That little one there.
If anybody asks you, oh, just who I am, please tell them I am redeemed.
Hallelujah.
I am redeemed. I've been bought with precious price.
Come on, church, I want to hear you singing
Jesus
over there. Come on, congregation, would you stand? Congregation, would you please stand and worship the Lord with us?
Wherever you are, I want to share a testimony with you right now, but I want to use the testimony to pray for you on a day like this. You know, I came in here this morning, I don't know what it is, so weak. So, you know when you just feel weak? I just felt weak. No matter what I drank, no matter what I ate, I was just weak. And even as I got closer to church, it was almost, you know, when the enemy is saying to you, get back home and sleep. I said, I ain't going back home. I'm coming to the house of God. And I'm going to trust God because I need the strength. And then suddenly when I saw Bishop say, man, let's pray. I said, now I need strength. Because I love to be used by God to pray. And then as I come back and I come out here, my goodness, even as I'm speaking to you, it's like the strength is rested on my head. It's like it's rested. I'm just feeling. It's like, what happened there? What happened between there and here? And I want to pray for you right now, using the same testimony. That on a day like this, if you are weak, if you feel weak and you need strength in any area of your life, in your spirit, in your soul, in your body, can you just put your hand on your head, man? Strength rises when we wait on the Lord like this. Strength rises when we wait on the Lord like this. My Father and my God who is my strength and shield. Jesus Christ. Yes, we talk about your death, your crucifixion. We talk about your burial. We talk about your resurrection. We talk about what you had to go through. But the Bible says you got to a place whereby even you were weak. You were weak concerning it all, and you went to your father and you said, Father, is it possible that I don't take this cup? It was your own moment whereby you needed strength. It was your own moment whereby you needed something to help you, to have courage and to be strength to do it. And you said, but Father, not my will, but your will be done. And the Bible says, the moment Jesus said, not my will, but your will be done, the Bible says, and the angel, and they gave him what? Strength. Suddenly, strength for the call, strength for the cause, strength to redeem, strength to do the work came upon Jesus. As it was then, so it is now and forevermore. As your hand is on your head, I want you to say, Lord, not my will, but your will. Not my will, but your will. Not my will, but your will be done. In the name of Jesus Christ. 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 And I declare, receive strength. Receive strength. Receive strength in your body, in your soul, in your spirit, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. By the power of his resurrection, receive it. By the power of the abundant life, receive the strength. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Just raise your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Believe God that what is spoken and the word that is in your heart will germinate is the living word of God, and it must come to pass. Hallelujah. Thank God there's still room on the cross. And those of you who come this day was asking God to come into your heart. Remember, what you ask of him, he is faithful to do. He is faithful to do in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I just want to let you know that there's refreshment outside. Can't hear you. Just be quiet, relax. When they're all going, they can go to you. Evan, would you come, please? And Pastor Aragon already? Okay. Come, Pastor Glenn. Are you? So the whole church going away like that? Amen. Yvonne just remind me that she's traveling tomorrow, is it? And her sister will be with both of you going to the States. Where are you going? and she's going to Morocco. Stretch your hands here. Holy Father, I'm asking you to bless your child. I'm asking you to lift her up. Stretch your hands and protect her. And watch over her in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for your goodness. You have been always faithful. And you can never change because you're God. I'll pray you'll take her and bring her back safely to us in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Come. Father, I'm asking you that you will bless Marcia. Watch over Marcia and keep her always in your presence. Thank you for this opportunity of going away for some days. Help her to be conscious that you are there. In Jesus' precious name, amen. And don't move, please. Sister Jennifer wants to make a special announcement.
Just to say to our saints that this Saturday is the start of the worship course that we've been announcing for weeks. I know some of you are still on the fence, not quite sure if you want to be here, but I will give you the opportunity. The course starts this Saturday. It's only for a few hours. It's 10:30 to 2:30, and it's only for 6 weeks. Faith spoke about the restoration. For us to maintain what we have received today, it takes teaching and walking the journey. For those who are visiting, you don't have to be a singer, you don't have to be a dancer. This course is teaching the believer how to raise the weapon of praise in dark and difficult times.
Hallelujah.
This course helps us to maintain the principles of worship. So when we get the breakthrough in our houses, we give praise, and when we come on a Sunday, it's an overflow. God is raising up the worshipers, because he's doing it for his return. So it is your opportunity to come. Many of you have done the courses before. Here is your opportunity again. Grab a flyer when you're going out. Call those who are maybe watching. 07956-572-110 is the number. You can replay the recording and hear the number again. Call us. We're here to serve you. Bless you.
Hallelujah. Thank you.